My name's Jonathan, I'm from Jubilee Debt Campaign. We've got a great lineup of people to talk about one of the biggest issues facing Europe, if not the biggest issue, and we're just going to go straight into them. So first of all, we've got Marina Prentoulis, who is from the University of East Anglia and is a spokesperson for Syriza in London. And you've probably seen her on TV over the last 6 months, once or twice. So Marina, over to you.
What is that puzzle? Yeah, the worst that pass of Syriza.
You have your chance to say that at the end. We're listening to this, yeah. But
okay.
But you won't.
But then
you won't go. No,
wait, save it. Save it. We'll get. Yeah.
Okay. So I have talked about some things before about austerity in Greece and what happened. And today I'm not very well prepared. But neither we were prepared as Greeks when the crisis hit us. So, okay, we managed again. Now, the crisis, as I said before, started in 2010 for us. We didn't realize that the crisis, the economic crisis of 2008, may have an effect on Greece. The general perception was like, okay, we're a small country, we are not a big financial center, okay, it won't have an effect. And then suddenly, in 2010, the then Prime Minister, George Papandreou, announced that it would be under the lending mechanisms of Troika. With Troika, we mean the three main institutions responsible for that, the IMF, the European Central Bank, and the European Commission. So since then, there were different lending agreements, we call memoranda, which they were imposing austerity in Greece. There was a very specific idea behind that from the side of the institutions, that if you impose austerity, this will allow us to repay the debt at some point. An idea that, of course, most of us know that it's not going to happen and it's not going to work, but still that was the rationale behind the imposition of austerity, at least in terms of the public. So austerity for Greece meant unemployment, which in Greece reached and still is there, 30%, 60% among young people, huge cuts on pensions and wages up to 40%, privatizations, and changes in the labor market. That had to do with the abolition of lending, of collective bargaining, massive layoffs, which under the Greek law, especially when it comes to public sector, were illegal, and so on. So with the imposition of austerity in Greece, the economy lost one-fourth, of its power. And then what happened progressively is that in 2015, Syriza came to power with a program which back then was mainly focusing on austerity and saying we are going to stop the lending agreements, we will not have austerity anymore. That was the general idea. Again, this didn't happen, and I have to say from the beginning, we were defeated. There is no reason why to try to say something different. It was a defeat. But still, I'm not totally pessimistic. I think not everything is lost for, not only for Greece, but for all of us. Yeah? But we have to recognize our defeat so we can learn from our mistakes and what happened. So I wanted to outline a little bit what happened with the negotiations. There were some key moments in these negotiations. They started immediately after Syriza came to power in January 2015, and the main strategy, let's say, from the side of the institutions that they were negotiating was to discredit the Greek government. So all the time, and this was happening on a daily basis, they were saying, oh, but you don't have any proposals, there are no proposals here, you didn't send us the documents that we have asked, and always trying to discredit what was happening from the Greek side. Now, this was took quite a few months, and then in 25th of June, there was an ultimatum from the side of the institution saying this is the deal, either you take it or leave it. And the deal was horrific. It was again still heavy austerity. Now, Because of this ultimatum, on June 30th, so after a few days, capital controls started in Greece. Capital controls from the side of the Greek government, we mean that we are trying to protect any money that they are still in the banks and you don't have a flight of capital. And people were allowed to withdraw very little money from cash machines or the banks. I think it was at that point 60 euros per day, which if you think about it, it's not very little, I mean, for a lower income or middle income family. Now, the reason, however, behind these capital controls is because the Greek government sent a petition to the European Stability Mechanism to allow, to give funding to Greece so the Greek banks will not totally collapse. And they refused. This refusal was a political refusal. The European Stability Mechanism shouldn't have reacted like that because it is within the European institution that they should try to provide stability for the whole European Union and the Eurozone area. So since they refused to supply more money to the Greek banks and there was this danger, there were the capital controls imposed. And at that point, the Syriza government thought that, I think they thought, I have to say, I'm not paid by Syriza, I'm not their officer, they are not paying me to talk about Greece. So I wouldn't have an insight, I'm not talking to Tsipras, and I don't know the guy. So I think what was going on there is that the Greek government thought that they need a strong democratic mandate from the side of the Greek people in order to go back and say, look, the Greek people rejected austerity, effectively. And this is what happened at Tsipras called the referendum on July 5th. The referendum, I personally wasn't thinking that we are going to win on that. Having the banks closed, that means having capital controls. It's a very strange situation on the Greek people. And yet, the referendum was won with 62%, which they rejected austerity. There was a big fight around that because some people were saying, yeah, but it is against the Eurozone and the European Union. But it had become clear by the government that this was related to austerity measures. One of the reasons for that is that still the Greek public is very much pro-European for reasons that we can discuss later on if you want. I don't know if that will be the future, I have to say, but up to that point at least. So, we have the referendum, the Greek government goes back to the negotiating table thinking that they have a strong card to play. They didn't. The institutions wouldn't back off. And I think at that point, we have to say that we were a little bit naive in thinking that they will take it back and do something different, because again, their decisions were not economic and rational, they were political decisions. You cannot have in a neoliberal Europe, which wants to impose austerity everywhere, a government that it is going to do something different. So they didn't take that back. On July 12th, they sent a horrible proposal in terms of the memorandum. I mean, it was frightening in the first instance. The idea there was that a lot of Greek assets would be transferred to a bank in Luxembourg. So that means all the wealth of the country will be transferred there and managed by a body outside Greece. It changed a little bit, but by July 15th we had an agreement again that it was imposing austerity. On July 13th, sorry, we had an agreement that it was imposing austerity. We had accepted it and we had been defeated. But the strange thing that happened at the same time is why these three institutions all this time were operating together. By July 15th, IMF breaks off and it says, you know what, now we have to tell you that the debt is not sustainable. All this time, their position was that austerity will allow us to pay the debt. Now they come out and they say, oh, you know what, it's not sustainable. So the institutions split there, the deal had been already signed, and this is one of the examples to show how when they need to push a decision, they stick together, but then when it comes to who's going to be involved in the process of what is happening with Greece, they broke sides and each one was looking after their own involvement and what would be better for them. But they said at that point what we have been saying for the whole year, that the debt is not sustainable. And everybody knew that. It was 120% in relation to the GDP when the crisis started. It had increased to 180 by that point in summer. And if austerity goes on as it is, most probably in the next couple of years it will be about 200%. So we know that austerity is not working. We know that we lost. And then now what we have to do is negotiate the debt. Which again, it's a very difficult proposition because the only way for this to become sustainable is to have a write-off. And I don't think they're going to do that. They are going to extend probably the repayments of the debt and so on. In Greece at that point, we had the creation of a truth commission on the public debt. The results are quite well known and not very surprising. It explained that the debt had nothing to do with excessive spending but with high rates in terms of the creditors. It had to do with military spending. It had to do with loss of tax revenue in Greece. And also, of course, that the first loan that we got back in 2010, it wasn't aiming to the Greek people. It was given to Greece in order to save the Greek and European private banks and to reduce the exposure that these banks had to Greek government bonds. What I want to end up with is that in all this situation, and despite the economics and the economics of the situation, and the different proposals that we had in relation to how we can deal with the Greek economy, in all this story we have, from my part at least, I believe to understand that it was a political project and it's neoliberalism imposing austerity. It has nothing to do with sound economics. The economics don't match. They are not going to work out, and it is a political project. So my argument will be that we have to bring economics, not to look at them as a different sphere where we have better proposals and arguments. This story has nothing to do with rationality. It has to do with the imposition of certain politics. And of course, it questions the politics of neoliberalism, not only in relation to Greece, but in relation to the future of the Eurozone and the European Union as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marina, and we'll go into those issues a lot more later. We now have Luis Moreira from Portugal to talk about the situation in Portugal, which I think we're probably all quite interested in right now. So, Luis.
Hi. Is this working? So, as Marina was saying, right now there's this neoliberal austerity agenda in Europe. So what's been happening in Portugal is not that different from what happened in Greece. Although everyone in Portugal are saying that we are not Greece. We are not, but we are not that far from Greece. There's this debt is being used as a political argument. Just like Marina was saying, this is not about economic, it's not about figures, it's political. So there's this political dispute between these liberals, neoliberals, and the left, whatever you want to call it, and they're using debt to put their agenda. So they are saying that you live above your means, so because of that, you have a very big debt in Portugal, in this case. And because of that, you need to go through austerity measures in order to pay this debt. So this is their argument. Well, it's not working. That's the first thing. Clearly, it's not working. In Portugal, what happened was in 2008, with the crisis, there was a political choice to save the bank, the banks, to rescue the banks. Because of that, our debt went up a lot. So in 2008, we had around 70% of our GDP, and now it's in 130, so double this ratio. Not only because the debt went up, but also because the GDP declined. So what does this mean? Because everyone is saying around Europe that they are trying to show Portugal as a success case. So in Portugal, we all say that we are the good student, bom aluno. But I think we should ask who's the teacher. Because if the teacher is the financial markets, then yes, that's very correct. We are a very good student. We are paying huge interest rates. We are paying our debt. Our debt is stable, so to speak, in the eyes of who owns the debt. This is a very good deal for them. So yes, we are being a good student. But if the teacher is the Portuguese people, then no, things are very tough there. So that's what is happening right now in Portugal. So every time that you hear that Portugal is a successful case, well, this is what is happening. This is success for them. The wages were cut as well, pensions. The homeless people increased in Portuguese main cities, Lisbon, Porto. So this is what been happening in the last years. In Portugal, we also had a memorandum imposed by the Troika. Once again, this was not to pay the debt or whatever, it was to rescue the banks, once again, the financial sector in Portugal. That was very, very clear in Portugal, because our former prime minister, before he called the Troika, in the day before, he had a meeting with the five biggest bankers in Portugal. So in Portugal, it's very clear what happened. They knocked on the government door and they say, we need money. So that's why they called the Troika. But yeah, they've been saying that Portugal is a successful case, but I think that's Ireland as well, in opposition to Greece. But I think it's not that different what's happening in Portugal right now and what's happening in Greece. So in the last few years, we had a right-wing coalition in power in Portugal. And they've been doing everything they're told, and very happily, by the Troika. So now, what happened in the last few weeks was we had the general elections of the parliament. And this coalition, they won with a relative majority, which, in case, it's not a real victory, because they weren't able to form a government. So they were defeated in parliament during this week. They present the president of Portugal, he imposed this right-wing coalition to government. But then their program was defeated in parliament. They were defeated by the left. So the big center-left party, that is the PS, Socialist Party, and then Left Bloc and the Communist Party. These three parties, they actually have the majority in parliament. So they voted against this right-wing government, and of course they won, because they have the figures. So now, this decision went back to the president. So now, theoretically, he has two choices, two options. One is to give polls to the left, okay? Let's say, okay, now it's your turn to try to form a government, which I think he will do that. And he could do something else. He could call for a caretaker government. I don't know if that's the right expression. But that would be seen as very, very, very undemocratic. And I don't think he's willing to take that risk. Because that, well, it wouldn't make sense. And so probably what will happen is that we will have a change in Portugal. So this right wing will leave the government, and the left will be in power. When I say the left, who's going to be in government? It's going to be PS only. But they will have the support of Bloco de Esquerda and the Communist Party in Parliament. If it's going to be a last longing government, we will see. Because usually, I don't know if you know, but like this left center, Partido Socialista, the Socialist Party, usually they're not very friendly with the Communist and the left bloc. This is a very exceptional moment in Portugal. I think it's very important to underline this because usually the PS and the left, they don't agree. They don't support each other. But because of all this austerity, all this right-wing 4 years government, they were able to create this alliance, coalition, whatever you want to call it. If they will change the politics, the policies, well, they won't change much. PS, it's a pro-Eurozone party, pro-European Union, and under this European Union frame, it's very hard to break with austerity. So I think we should, as Europeans, because what's happening here in this country is also not that different. There's all this rhetoric from Osborne that's saying that we need to pay the debt. And in order to do that, you're gonna have to pay it with your taxes, with your wages, and that's what's happening right now, also in this country. So this is a European, at least, not to say global, struggle fight between this austerity neoliberals and everyone else. So I think it's very important to unite, to talk as Europeans, and to learn with each other's experience. And I think, let's see what this government will bring to Portugal, how it will work, how long will last, if they will have the support of the left, the radical left, if you want to call them, in parliament, or if they will eventually split, and what will that create. We're also gonna have elections for the president in the beginning of next year. I don't think it would be very interesting, to be honest. The right wing, they have a very strong candidate, and the left is. So probably we will have again a right wing president. But let's see.
Thank you very much, Luis. Now we have Andy Storey, who is a lecturer at the University of Dublin and part of the Justice and Human Rights NGO Action from Ireland.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. And I want to do something very similar to what Lewis just did for Portugal, which is to challenge some myths about the acclaimed Irish success story. As many of you will know, Ireland has an enormous debt burden, largely arising out of the socialisation of private sector debt, bank debt, that was guaranteed by the state. And which the cost of which has been in excess of 37% of total Irish economic output. Some of that may get recouped, but we're certainly looking at a 25% hit in the size of the Irish economy that has been sacrificed effectively to bail out private bankers. In next year's budget, it's estimated that debt interest payments will be about 6.6 billion euros, which represents about 18% of total tax revenues, or almost 5% of GDP. So Ireland's debt crisis has very much not gone away. Some of you may have heard of claimed restructuring of Irish debt. There has been a restructuring of a portion of the debt. There has been no write-down of the debt. It has been stretched out into the future. I can talk more about that if people are interested in the technical details of that. Okay. Despite that still crushing debt burden, has there been an economic recovery? There has been growth in GDP, in gross domestic product, in the last few years, but those figures are very unreliable. If you see those quoted in the Financial Times or anywhere else, you have to remember that they are hugely distorted by the pricing activities of multinational companies, which account for an enormous proportion of Irish exports and claimed Irish output. I'll just give you one example from the last couple of weeks. Corporation profits tax proceeds in Ireland this year are running about 2 billion euros ahead of forecast. That's about 74% higher than it was forecast they would be. Now that's pretty weird. Coincidentally, or not, Apple Corporation's non-US operations are paying a higher rate of tax, you don't quite know yet where, than they had been in previous years. Now what's clearly happening is that in response to European and American criticism of its tax avoidance measures, Apple is booking more of its profits in Ireland and therefore inflating Irish profit figures and inflating the overall rate, apparent rate of growth in the economy. It doesn't mean there isn't a real payoff. Apple does employ quite a lot of people in Ireland, and it is obviously going to pay more tax this particular year. But overall, the reason it does that, the reason it is in Ireland, as with many other tech companies, is precisely to avoid tax. I'll just give you one other example in that regard. Google last year declared turnover in Ireland of 18.3 billion euros. It paid tax in Ireland of 28.6 million euros. And of course, a lot of that income was not generated in Ireland. Really, it was generated here in Britain, in other European countries, but declared in Ireland, thereby artificially inflating export and profit figures. Now, financial fictions aside, I'm trying to, in a sense, play devil's advocate to some extent here from the point of view of people who claim there has been a recovery. Financial fictions aside, has there been real economic progress for people on the ground? Some of the indicators are perhaps positive. Unemployment this year is likely to fall below 10%, which is down from a peak of 14% at the height of the crisis, still nowhere near as severe as the horrendous unemployment situation in Greece, for example. However, bad enough. And again, we have to query how much meaning we can attach to those figures. Since around 2009, 2010, you've had net emigration of about 123,000 people. Over that same period, the number of people unemployed fell by 97,300. So emigration has accounted for a significant chunk of the fall in unemployment. So also has the growth of unpaid internships and various other unpaid work schemes or make-up work schemes. And also what a chunk of employment growth has been in unpaid, temporary, insecure, flexible, 0 hours, whatever term one wishes to apply, type contracts. Over 19% of all people at work suffer multiple deprivation. And Damon in the last session mentioned this when he was talking to those of you who are here. He was talking about how the British government always said, well, work is the answer. Work is the answer to poverty. But the idea that work and poverty are incompatible, it has to be increasingly challenged. They're not. They often go hand in hand. Now, is there any good news in all this? Well, there is. There has been a surge in employment in one particular sector, and it's not unpaid, it's not temporary, it's not insecure work for the most part. It's in computer services. And those, for the most part, are pretty good jobs. They're often offering kind of health benefits and so on that would traditionally associate with the good public service jobs. So what you're talking about here are the aforementioned Google, Apple, PayPal, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. They all have their headquarters in our significant operations in Ireland. There's a part of Dublin that has come to be referred to as Silicon Docks. It's about down by the river. It's got a lot of these companies based in it. Okay, you're probably waiting for the qualification or the caveat, and here it comes. There are caveats to that use as well. First of all, of course, it's largely based upon what I mentioned already, which is tax avoidance. So therefore, in a European or global context, it's also contributing to problems and the depriving of governments of tax revenue, which of course also means it's vulnerable to challenges. The European Commission has issued a challenge against Apple's tax treatment. There's always the possibility that advantage will be eroded. There's also the problem, and this is by no means an anti-immigrant argument, figures are not kept on how many of those jobs go to Irish people. anecdotal evidence suggests that between half and two-thirds go to non-Irish people, in part because, and don't get me wrong, we need all the help we can get to diversify the Irish gene pool and so on. So I'm wholly in favour of this immigration. It's great, and the jobs wouldn't be here at all, you know, or in Ireland at all, absent that immigration. But it does mean that the employment prospects for Irish people are less than they might appear from the basis of those figures. And they're not going to get any better anytime soon, because a key qualification for those jobs are the linguistic skills that Irish people typically don't possess, like English people as well, I think, to some extent. I think our excuse might be that we still think that English is a foreign language, and therefore we're already making a concession by learning that, but I would learn French or Spanish or German. But there are other problems, and this has attracted a lot of attention in recent weeks and months. Even some of those companies are talking about some of the problems they're facing: rising housing costs, rising problems of infrastructure in terms of education, in terms of transport, and so on. So that also may pose a threat to the long-term survival of those companies in Ireland. Ireland's investment ratios, especially public investment, remain remarkably low by European and international standards. So a key point that I want to make here is that austerity did not prompt what growth there has been. That growth in that kind of enclave multinational sector was largely immune to austerity. But austerity, having depressed growth, especially through depressing domestic demand in 2008, 2009, 2010, is now possibly threatening even that enclave sector by failing to provide the critical infrastructure and social needs in terms of housing and education that that sector possibly needs to continue to thrive. And while employment for some has grown, so also have indicators of quite severe social suffering. I mentioned working people's deprivation earlier on. Deprivation in total is now estimated to impact upon some 1.4 million Irish people, about a third of the population. That's up 128% since 2008. In 2008, a little less than 7% of Irish children lived in poverty. In 2013, the last year for which we have data, that figure had risen to almost 12%. It's probably gone higher since then. We've also got very high, again echoing some of the points from the last session, but very high levels of household debt, mortgage arrears, rising rates of evictions, of house repossessions, and so on. And those indicators, which are what people feel on the ground, because most people don't work for Google, but don't work for Facebook, they're experiencing a very different lived reality. And it means the government seems startled and somewhat angry that it's not getting credit for this claimed economic recovery. Of course, they're not, because people are not feeling it in their lives, and there's widespread popular anger. That's been most manifest in a massive grassroots campaign against the introduction of water charges. In principle, and most people don't have the difficulty with water taxation, if it's been used to fund a public service and been used to upgrade the water supply. But people are fearful that this is a prelude to privatisation of the water supply. They're also simply resisting another tax, another new tax, another imposition in already in lives that are already quite tough. That movement, which is, as I said, grassroots, but also has the support of some of the more, if you like, radical trade unions, coalesced under the umbrella of Right to Water. It's now morphed into something called Right to Change, and it's trying to build not exactly a left coalition in Ireland, but it's trying to build a set of agreed policy principles that left and independent parties could sign up to as a basis for a possible government when the next elections occur, likely to occur early next year, so in a few months' time. Now, even with that momentum, it's highly unlikely that the next government will be left-led. But, and this is the point I want to finish on, even if a radical left movement did lead the next government in Ireland, then it would face exactly the same challenge that Marina has documented for Greece. An absolutely implacable European Union committed to crushing any alternative economic program. So my closing comment, and I think I've mentioned this again in the last session, I think this is very obviously very relevant in terms of current debates in Britain, but coming at this from a left rather than a right perspective, a la UKIP and so on, we have to face the reality that such an alternative economic programme cannot be implemented, in my view, while Ireland or Portugal or Greece or anywhere else for that matter remains a member of the Eurozone. It just can't happen in the current architecture, or even perhaps a member of the European Union. So debates around left exits of the European Union and the Eurozone, I think, have to be very firmly on our agenda if we do really wish to reverse and find an alternative to debt and austerity.
Thank you very much, Andy. And our fourth speaker is Isidorus Daikides. Is that how I say it? He's the co-chair of the Greece Solidarity Campaign, which has been a fantastic campaign in the UK, working in solidarity with the people of Greece.
Thanks. It's Greek, so don't worry. Can I say, I think that I'm the chair of the Greece Solidarity Campaign. It was created in 2012 by the late Tony Benn, who was our founder and our first owner and president. Our favorites, including Jeremy Corbyn and other distinguished and distinct leaders. We have the support of the parliamentarians in Britain, mainly through the work of Paul McKinney, my co-chair, who is retired now but highly respected Canadian leader. And we are based completely on unpaid volunteers, and most of our work is focused on forging solidarity links with Greek and austerity forces, dispelling damaging myths, campaigning through writing articles, presentations, public meetings, demonstrations, other means of supporting the Greek population in this crucial of their history. We're completely and consciously independent of any political party, both here and in Greece. And this is important, we are determined to avoid the trap of trying to tell the Greeks what to do, or what they should be doing, focusing instead on ways to help them in whatever they are trying to do. That's why just a general introduction. What I'd like to paint is a very broad brush approach of where we are right now, and some of the campaign directions that we have and we recommend to everybody else as the result of the campaign. And I would like to...
I don't think that's working.
You can't hear.
No.
Yeah, but I'm probably not speaking to the mic. Yeah. I want to start with taking stock of what happened the last few months, the last year. And this was for us, again, a roller coaster year. And once more, as we have come to expect, our Greek comrades never let us down when it comes to adrenaline pumping drama and ups and downs and twists and turns and thrown by formulation, despair, and all that kind of thing. And so much happened in that year that it's difficult to imagine that it all happened within a year. Less than a year ago, Syriza had set itself as the government in waiting and surprisingly managed to find the opportunity to bring the then government down and force early elections took place in late January. And despite having the whole establishment, both in Greece and abroad, against it, to everybody's surprise, it managed to win these elections. And in doing so, it created the first left-wing government in Europe, if you remember, and so sent shockwaves through the establishment, and also it gave a big boost to all the progressive anti-austerity forces across Europe at the same time. And I tell you, if you were there that night in Greece watching the results coming in, you would have felt like so many of us, that we were part of history in the making at the time. But this elation was very short-lived. The establishment jumped straight away from the jugular from day one, determined to bring down the government before it started, and eventually effectively preventing it from governing all these months. And the Greeks were aware, I'm absolutely sure of that, that they had no illusions about how overwhelming the odds against them were, and that they were playing the role of a small, naked David against a mighty, well-armed Goliath
and so on, but they were determined to take on this establishment despite all that. They were aware that they were isolated in amongst European governments, although they were confident in the validity of their position, and therefore they embarked on a popular campaign designed to win hearts and minds amongst the people of Europe and to galvanize and strengthen Syriza-like anti-austerity parties in other countries. The President Varoufakis, you remember, became overnight celebrities across Europe, and the little David, if I put it that way, started inching his way into the sympathies of growing numbers of ordinary people in his uneven fight with this nasty Goliath. In the process, what the Greek government did is started lifting the veil, actually, and exposing to ordinary people the real nature of what was going on. And it was at the same time forcing the establishment to gradually drop the smiles and the pretensions that they are a caring partner and so on, and to bare its teeth. And it was clear from the very beginning, as other speakers said, that this was not about finances, it was not about Greece itself, but part of a wider, much bigger political issue. There's no need to rehearse again here the obvious tragic statistics, the humanitarian crisis, the evident self-defeating nature of deflationary austerity policies and forced privatizations. I'm sure no one here has got any doubt about it. But it's clear that this is not about Greece, of the Greek national debt, or helping Greece to get out of the recession, but it's about using Greece as a guinea pig for introducing into Europe and consolidating a neoliberal political regime that includes the dismantling of the post-war welfare state consensus. And part of this is testing in Europe for the first time techniques that hitherto were reserved for developing countries, including encouraging and then manipulating national debt as an instrument of forcing reluctant governments and populations to accept the imposition of exploitative neoliberal austerity and privatization policies. And part of our success as a campaign in convincing the unions is that our unions have clearly understood that Greece is the front line in a wider war between all European progressive forces on one hand and an international neoliberal establishment. In parallel, and this is an important point I want to bring out, is once the little Greece had the audacity to take on this and raise its head against this establishment, this establishment became determined it will crush it and will make it an example to any other country and population that may think of going down the same route of challenging this neoliberal project. So what happens is that whatever this Syriza government was fighting there, it was inextricably linked in more than one level with the rest of us, with everybody else in Europe. You couldn't separate them anymore. Now, last summer, the situation, as Marina described, reached an impasse, with the bullying, the blackmailing, etc., reaching a crunch point. Government held that referendum in the hope that by demonstrating that it still got the support of the Greek people, it would strengthen its hand. The referendum was convincingly won again, despite everybody, all the establishment has thrown everything it's got in it, and there was elation again for a while. Its control over the liquidity of the Greek banks and exploited that ruthlessly to force the Greek government at the time into a humiliating come down and to sign another deal which, despite some minor concessions in it, is effectively accepting another referendum and the associated usual memorandum about austerity measures and privatizations. Not surprisingly, the Syriza party back in Greece was devastated. More than a third of its MPs refused to accept the deal, and they forced the government to rely on the opposition votes to get it through. To get it through, and a number of the dissatisfied MPs decided also to leave the party. forcing it to early elections. And again, despite the vast efforts of the establishment to prevent a Syriza victory because they wanted a united national government and all that kind of thing, Syriza won once more comprehensively and returned to the government a victor, but a just and unchastised one, I would say. Unfortunately, the breakaway party, which tragically misinterpreted the mood of the country and the referendum, didn't manage to succeed in getting even the 3% threshold and everything needed to be represented in the parliament. And as a result, some of the best and more sort of like able anti-austerity voices in Greece were left sort of marginalized, I hope not for very long as well. The government now arguing that losing this battle wasn't the same as losing the war is determined to fight back, is licking its wounds and soldering on, is regrouping, preparing its alternative ways, exploiting in the process the limited gains that it made, particularly an element of flexibility in how to implement the measures, and more than important than anything else for us, the general agreement that the debt is unsustainable and needs some drastic action, probably restructuring, probably write-offs. On its side, nevertheless, and that is relevant to what we're discussing, it had something else, that the setback hasn't actually, it doesn't seem to have stopped the advances of the anti-austerity parties that it had helped itself to inspire across Europe. In the next few months, there are real, realistic possibilities that in Portugal, Spain and Ireland, we would have radical parties being parts of coalition government. The amazing sort of like success of Jeremy Corbyn here, and the leadership who is a patron of our organization, as well as the resilience of the other Syriza-like, if I put it that way, movements in Germany, in France, in other countries, and the recent creation of a new Syriza-like party in Italy that just happened this week, to be launched, etc. All this creates some kind of optimism, ground of optimism, that for the future this Greek government will not be completely isolated when it deals with other governments in Europe, but it might have some allies within it as well. So I'll completely say that it's clear in my view, taking all this into account, that instead of getting lost in detailed analysis and arguments about past developments and who was important, etc., we have to realize that Greece is still the front line on our war, and that maximum unity amongst progressive forces is essential if we are to win this war. The recent explosion of the refugee crisis, with Greece finding again itself at the eye of the storm, it adds another key dimension to the central role that this little country is playing for all of us who are fighting for a better world and for reclaiming our Europe from the neoliberal cancer that threatens its very nature. The forthcoming negotiations, I'm almost finished, the forthcoming negotiations around the long-term sustainability of the Greek debt are a clear target for our campaign, and in this I would like to mention as well the work of the Greek Parliament's Committee on the Truth About the Debt, whose interim report has done a lot to lift the veil of secrecy over what's really going on in this field. And I would urge us that we help to disseminate its interim findings and to find a way of continuing this work and encouraging others to start similar initiatives in other countries. The Greek Solidarity Campaign will continue its work, including strengthening its pan-European dimension and its links with other sister campaigns in other countries, working with the Jubilee Campaign on supporting the Greek case for making the Greek debt sustainable, assisting our Greek comrades and their government in their continuing efforts to cope with the effects of the austerity and privatization that's forced upon them, and to find a way out of this neoliberal stranglehold. I'll stop here, and I didn't go to any details. I hope that we will be able to answer in more detail any issues that particularly want to go to get into more debt. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Isidris. Now we have about 20 minutes for questions and discussion. We've heard a very good overview from our speakers and also some of the key issues are coming out. What do you think about the Euro and the Eurozone and the European Union in relation to these questions of debt? And what can we do here to support the struggle against austerity around Europe? I'm going to take maybe clusters, maybe two or three points at a time, and then we'll just go back to the panel for any comments. I've got one at the front here, and one in the middle of the back. Come and get, yeah. Owen, you come and sort us out with the microphone. Thank you very much.
Thank you. This is not quite within what you suggested, but this is heresy. What would have happened if the banks had been allowed, the banks in Greece had been allowed to collapse?
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? Now, of course, in the UK, we're actually going to have a referendum. There is a possibility we could choose to leave the EU. I think probably all of you mentioned the possibility of your own countries leaving the EU. Is there any realistic possibility of that happening in the way it's happening in the UK? Or is it something which at the moment is not really on the agenda yet? And if it is a possibility, is there a possibility of all the countries collaborating and perhaps leaving en masse? And that does actually include the UK as well, if we decide that's the right option for the UK. Thank you.
And then centre.
Yeah, thank you. Moin Yassin from Global Vision 2000. Some monetary reformers claim we have a lull before a storm. In other words, another crash. Everything that's being done is Humpty Dumpty being, you know, patched, and he's going to fall down again. Now, if you accept that analysis or diagnosis, my point is this. There has been critiques on organizations like Global Research, etc., about how the opposition by the peoples, yeah, to austerity is being sabotaged. I don't want to mention names. So my point is this. I mean, the gentleman mentioned from Greece that certain people in the know resigned from, you know, the party. So my point is this. Are European peoples aware of what they are dealing with? You know, how do you deal with a banker's government? Because we have been led post-war in so-called democratic liberal societies to believe that, you know, we have benign governments, you know, who work for the common good, la-di-la. I humbly submit we need a diagnosis, those who want to change the system, to understand power politics and the banking elite. I think we need a crash course. I'd like to raise that. Thank you.
Okay. We'll come back to another round in a minute, but let's just have a let's start on
you. Well, if the banks were allowed to collapse, or there is another, because there were the scenario about what would happen if Greece would say, no, we're not doing any of what you're demanding, we're getting out. First of all, we have to remember that Greece is a country which is importing, I think, something like 70% of its products. And that means that we are buying everything, even oranges and things like that. So I guess one of the immediate effects that you have is that progressively you would have shortage of food, you would have panic in the streets. So I think for some time it will be a very big chaos happening. In economic terms, according to people who already have tried to figure out if only economics were the game, what would have happened in Greece was to go out of the Eurozone, which probably if you allow the banks to collapse, if Greece says, no, we are not going to accept any of the proposals, there is a possibility that they would have asked Greece to leave the Eurozone, probably the European Union, although there is no legal mechanism to do so. But I'm sure they would have invented it. So I think they said that there would be two or three years where you have inflation, the Greek drachma will be about 40% below the euro and a very difficult situation, increased unemployment for 3-4 years. And probably after that you may start seeing things going better. The problem is that this is the economic scenarios. If you look economically, how it will work, that is the case. But I don't think it's that simple, because it's politics, as I said. And the way that instability can be created in countries like Greece, it's not beyond what I think the European Union would have attempted. I'm trying to say that I'm really afraid of how far they're willing to go. In terms of the European referendum, there is an agreement that this European Union is not the European Union we want. But then there is a question of strategy and tactics about how we are going to push this idea when the UK referendum is going to happen and which position each one is going to take. There are people who will campaign for no, there are people who will campaign for yes. I'm from the people that will campaign for yes, but we need to change Europe now. I do work with people who will say no as well. But then, because both effectively, I mean, I could say let's try to change the European Union. That doesn't mean that it can happen. That doesn't mean that we have a way of, we are very clear of how we are going to do it. And the same, I think, it goes for the no position, what it would be. It's just that in Britain, I think the no, we play more for the extreme right. I may be wrong, but this is my feeling. Again, the position that we have to change Europe, it's not something that it comes automatically for larger audiences. To push an idea like that in the public domain, it's quite difficult. It's not that because we gather here and we say this is the case, it's going to find a much bigger audience, an audience outside those people who are already interested and have followed these debates. Did I answer this question?
And this country is going out from Europe. England is going out soon from European Union. Why don't you go out for
the can I just add something to this?
I don't know if England is going to go out from the European Union, and then we have to think also what would that mean. If it has a conservative government, it will be mean for me that it will follow American foreign policy even more than it already does. So it will be even more of a laptop for the US. So it doesn't necessarily mean that because it's going to go out, things will magically become much better. Politics are quite long processes, and it takes quite a lot of work to bring things to a direction where you really have changed. In terms of the question about the left and what happened with some people that they left Syriza, yes, of course, this is the case, and they didn't feel that they could go on supporting the government and the project, and I have nothing to say against them. What I have to say against is that the left lives in a fantasy world. For me, it lives in a fantasy world because it thinks that because you have one government in a small country like Greece, things will change automatically. It is in a fantasy world because it thinks that if somebody stands up and says, no, we have to change it, it's going to change magically. And I think the processes, and we've seen that, are much longer and much more painful. And for me, it will be better to stick together and attack our enemies, then start attacking each other. I don't think this takes us anywhere. On the other side, you have people, those that they are the servants of international capital, that they do a much better job in staying together. When they mess up, they still stay together. They don't break that easily. We are quite weak in this respect. We are really very very much ready to get on each other's throat. So I think if what we've learned something from Greece is that the process is not going to be easy, we are going to be defeated, and we have to have always a question of how we move ahead. And in order to do that, is that we have to collaborate across countries. Not one small country will come up and the world will change. If that was the case, we would have already won, but we didn't. Thank you.
Yeah, can I just say, as regards to the banks and leaving the banks, what would happen? I think, rather my personal opinion, I would just say that the Greek government at the time had begun its head because the rich people had taken all their money out of the country. The only ones who had cut money in these banks were the medium and low income people, their savings and small companies, etc. And every day that the banks were closed or had their controls, the economy was going on there. People were suffering genuinely. So it was a real thing. If we were to get out, we should. Can I just start? Can people hear me that way?
Yeah.
If we were to get out, we should do it with a proper planned way rather than just with a gun on our heads. That was the thing. And I can't help thinking that the country with the biggest draw on its national debt the last 5 years is Iceland, the one who put two fingers up to its banks, basically when it was the same crisis as it was, and didn't follow the orthodoxy.
It's not in the euro.
It's just a general thing. But as regards leaving the euro, again, right, not my personal opinion, what the Greek situation was. This Syriza party, for good or bad, believes in representing genuinely what people want, and people had for years been cynical about it. And the people gave it a schizophrenic mandate. On the one hand, we don't want to do what the European Union wants us, and on the other hand, we want to stay in the European Union, come what may. So the only choice that they had was to try to change the European Union. Now, it might look impossible, that kind of thing. I might have a lot of sympathies personally with leaving the euro in order to rebuild it from scratch, but nevertheless, one of the key ways is. And that explains why the Greek government has gone the way it's gone and seems that it's gone the way it's gone, is to try to change some of the governments of Europe. Because in the recent period, all we've got is right-wing governments across Europe. So if we change a few of those at least, we might go back to the old days, if we remember when Jacques Delors was, etc., and we're talking about social Europe and how a lot of people in Britain were supporting the European Union as a hedge against what Thatcher was doing here. Yeah. That was the progressive part. Now it's the reverse, actually, completely. So it's a bit more complex. But from the Greek perspective, as I say, that is the strategy. They had no choice unless they would say two fingers to the people who voted for them.
You are much better as a Syriza spokesperson, actually.
I'll answer the question. Somebody, I can't see you there. I think you asked the question, was there a realistic prospect of any of our countries leaving the EU or voting to leave the EU? I can only speak for my own, and the answer is absolutely none whatever. That's for a variety of reasons. Cultural attachment to Europe, or the European Union being seen as a liberal, cosmopolitan alternative to narrow Catholic conservative Ireland, but also a key reason is when I talked about US foreign direct investment, the reason it's in Ireland is to minimize its tax, but also to access the European market. So the cornerstone of Ireland's economic development strategy, which is essentially is development by invitation, would be threatened by leaving the Eurozone, never mind leaving the EU. If it were to happen, might the countries cooperate? I think that it would be ideal if they did. I think that would minimize some of the potential disruptions that Marina just talked about. So in a sense, but given that I don't think we will, that's kind of a moot point to some extent. On the other hand, it's the old Gramscian thing, it's pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. I'm pessimistic whether it will happen, but I think at some point, it's going to have to happen. The penny is going to drop at some point. I think sooner or later, the fundamentally neoliberal character of the European Union and the fact that it has been increasingly set in constitutional legal stone, I think that's going to have to be confronted. And, you know, I take the point that better if we had left-wing governments elected across Europe. But you could have 27 left-wing governments across Europe. You can't change the treaties without unanimous agreement. And you've got the supposedly depoliticized European Central Bank that isn't open to democratic governance. You've got the Commission that acts in a completely undemocratic way. This is a profoundly undemocratic space that is going to be very, very difficult, and I would argue impossible to reform. I know that Europe is possible. I just don't think it's possible through these mechanisms and through these structures. And I do think that's the big elephant in the European room. And I think at the very least, we have to start acknowledging that it's sitting in the corner and causing us significant problems.
Well, I'll just talk about Europe. There's two discussions under the European Union. The European Union itself and also the Eurozone. It's two different things. In Portugal, right now, the left, we are having this discussion there. Both left bloc and the Communist Party agree in leaving the Eurozone. The European Union, I agree with. Irish colleague just said it's the same thing in Portugal. Right now it's impossible, but the Eurozone is another thing. I think it's a necessity if we want to break with the austerity to leave Eurozone and maybe also the European Union. As he said, it's not a democratic institution. It never was, and I don't think it will ever be. They have a program. Okay, it's about markets. It's about gain access to markets. That's the European project. And this argument of unity, that we need to be united, but under which umbrella? This is not our umbrella, it's not our Europe, it's the boss's Europe. So I have very different opinions than Marina.
What is the difference?
You want to stay in the European Union, I don't. But it's small difference. being a migrant in this country and having this referendum, it's tough, especially because I have this opinion. So a lot of my friends, Portuguese, they're saying, well, but you can't say that because they're going to kick us out of this country and you leave here. And it's a very good argument, but I don't think that will be like cause-effect that directly. And also, I think we need to think globally and look at the big picture and not as a personal interest. So if I could vote here in the next referendum, I would go for a no, clear no. But a left no, not like a UKIP no, and we need to make the argument that this no doesn't mean one, it's not a nationalist exit, okay? We want and we need to collaborate, to create links, whatever, but not under this frame. That's what I think. And well, once again, we are having this discussion in Portugal about the Eurozone, not the European Union. I don't think you will be easily won, but I think it's growing. Our argument is growing. People can see directly that the euro didn't bring anything good for them. So I think, yeah, we need to fight that.
Thank you.